Hi, it's Demma. I just made a video on cinnamon, very short video, cinnamon cassia oil, brand name plant therapy. I buy mine at Amazon.com. And I want to talk a little bit about my mom's small claims case. I made other videos about it, but I didn't really like them. So I'm going to make another one. Now, this is Queens County Courthouse. I'll give you some of my personal advice. I'll give some advice to landlords out there since my mom's case was a landlord-tenant situation. Considering my personal experience and the bias I have seen at Queens County Courthouse. I've also done research on Queens County Courthouse, spoken to other persons. They mistreat the elderly. They are known to mistreat the elderly, to be biased against them, to be biased and mistreat disabled persons. So, can you imagine if you're elderly and disabled, how badly they will treat you? And from my personal experience, being my mom's spokesperson, I spoke on behalf of her. I am her power of attorney. And considering she's in poor health, her English is very poor, even her comprehension of her own native Cypriot Greek language is somewhat on the poor side because she suffered a mini stroke in 2016. So I had to speak for her. And I have that legal right. I am her power of attorney. I was also her witness. My personal suggestion, if you're a Christian, if you're other than Jewish faith, if want to be fair, so if you're Christian, and especially I think if you're Cypriot Greek, because I find people very biased against Greek people for whatever their reasons are. I think especially if you're Christian, I think it has to do with being Eastern Orthodox Christian. I'm not Catholic Christian. I don't even consider myself Eastern Orthodox Christian because I don't want to belong to any religion. I believe in Christ wholeheartedly, without a doubt. I believe in all his teachings, and many of his teachings were not made known. You really have to seek it out yourself. I think that's why Greek people are biased against. I think it's because they are not Catholic Christian. It's because they are Eastern Orthodox Christian. There's a lot of history behind that. So I personally recommend you take a lawyer with you. And my personal advice is find a Jewish lawyer because a lot of the judges in Queens County Courthouse are of Jewish faith. Like Tracy Capitano Fox. I did some research about her after my mom's court case and the way she basically treated me and my mom. Did a lot of research on her. In the past, she has had a lawsuit, at least one that I know of, against her. For terminating, listen to this. Oh my God, this is how cold she is. For terminating a dying male cancer person. He was on chemotherapy. He was allowed to work from home. He was susceptible to diseases because of his chemotherapy, his immune system was low, and they allowed him to work from home. I believe he worked at the Civilian Complaint Review Board. Tracy Capitano Fox says to him one day, "You either come to work full time," I'm not quoting, "you can do it. You can do the research yourself on Google. You'll find all of what I'm saying is fact." She told him, "You either come to work every day or be terminated." I don't know 100% of the details. I do know this man filed a lawsuit against her. So obviously she must have terminated him. I've been researching how that lawsuit was settled. I can't find the information I'm looking for. I have to look deeper into it. I'm very curious. I imagine the man is deceased now since he was terminal. I think Tracy Capitano Fox, I think she's very cold-hearted. She will manipulate laws, in my personal opinion, to benefit herself. Like someone said on Facebook when we were discussing Queens County Court and the judges, they do not base their decisions on the law and the principle, but how can I say this? She used the word strategy. I guess what she meant, what suits them, what their own personal bias suits them. That's how I perceived it. The three former, and I call them bullies because in my opinion, in my strong perception, they are bullies. And the case number, I will give you the case number for my mom's small claims case. I was told I could use first names. Let me use case number 3451/17, 3452/17, 3453/17. Okay, these three former bully tenants, early 20s, they're from out of state, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Connecticut. They work in Manhattan. And obviously, in my mind, I can't comprehend how these three with such a deceptive, scamming, malicious mindset, spiteful, retaliatory mindset can work in the positions they are actually employed in. That's my personal opinion, and I'm entitled to it. They were spiteful really from day one. My mom being soft-hearted, widow, buried two daughters. I think she somehow subconsciously developed at first sight a sort of motherly wing. They're away from their parents, you know, their roommates to each other, maybe fresh out of college, starting new jobs, whatever the case. You know, she wanted to give them a chance in the lease. They signed a 1-year lease agreement, which they breached. One of the former, in my opinion, again, bully tenants, Janine, she comes August 8th, it was a Monday, August 8th, and asks my mom, the landlord, for keys. They signed a 1-year lease agreement, their move-in date, August 15th, and they have all the documents to prove it, everything. The lease agreement, I have the original. August 15th was their set move-in date. Why is Janine coming August 8th, asking my mom, my soft-hearted, soft-minded mom, for keys? My mom gave her a set of keys. When I heard that, I said, "You should not have done that, Mom." And landlords out there, Always get a lease agreement. Private home, building. I think in a building it's mandatory for a lease. I'm not sure. But in private homes, two family, three family, landlords lease. And make sure you put provisions in there that will protect you. Like, for example, you can get a standard lease from websites, or your realtor can provide you with one. And if you want to add clauses, provisions, like for example, tenants, you want to make your tenants responsible for their recycling. I think that's legal. You also have to make sure that what your provisions are don't go against the state laws. It's like basically research, or if you're elderly, or you're not computer literate, talk to people, ask for advice. So yeah, think about putting clauses in there to give you extra protection, landlord. So to move right along. Sorry, my nose is running. Must be allergies. So she comes and she asks for keys, and my mom gave her a set. The next day, Janine, Rachel, and Megan, they're coming into the premises after work, in and out. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, they didn't stay very long. In and out. It's like, not supposed to be here. August 15th is their move-in date. Also, delivery boxes were coming in their name to the premises before their set move-in date. And there was a plentitude of them, if that's even a word. And we had to store them in the hallway. There was, I think, one that was really huge and heavy. Couldn't even get it in the house. Yeah, they were like really rude and inconsiderate. They seem to give the mindset that it's all about them. No consideration for the landlord. No consideration for the lease agreement. No consideration for the home. So their boxes are being stored in the wall. So now we have red flag one. Janine comes in and asks for keys August 8th. Red flag two, delivery boxes. Delivery boxes. Actually, red flag two is them coming in and out of the premises. Red flag three. So now we have three red flags. Okay, there's a 1 year lease, so we're hoping, it doesn't get any worse. They come Friday. They bring some of the boxes upstairs. They're not supposed to be up in the apartment. They're leaving windows open. They don't lock the top lock. This is even after my mom reminded them. This is after I slid a note under their door. It's drizzling. Think property damage. This is a landlord's home. You're renting. Respect it. Shut and lock the windows. Why are you not locking the top lock to the street door? I mean, we live in a neighborhood where we have the highway, buses, subways. We live in a really good area where transportation is near. We have grocery stores near, shopping centers near. I mean, 5 minutes with car, you're in Manhattan. By subway, I think it's about 10, 12 minutes if the subways are running good. If they're not, that's another story. But we're right there at the tip of Manhattan. Lock the top lock. Lock the top lock, not just for your safety, but for the landlord's safety, the landlord's family safety, and whoever's living here. For everyone's safety, And you tell them once, you tell them twice. Okay, another red flag. When I slid a note under their door, at least I'm not even sure if they started locking the top lock then, but at some point they finally did, and the windows too. Yeah, I believe it was August 11th I slid that note under the door. And they were using my mom's, the landlord's, electricity. They didn't switch Con Edison over. I mean, they were supposed to move in August 15th. But here they are using landlord's electricity. And I mentioned that in the second note. I put the same note, but I mentioned the electricity. They left the fan on from August 11th with the intent to leave it on August 12th. If I didn't hear the humming noise in the bathroom, that fan would have been on till the next day when they came Sunday. And Sunday, August 12th, they're moving in. I was like, Mom, it's not August 15th. Why are they moving in today? Should you not say something? Did you get compensated for, let's see, they were supposed to move in August 15th. Yeah, it's August 13th was a Sunday, actually. I'm sorry. 13th, 14th, was it? Wait, let's think about that. The 15th was a Tuesday. Yes, it was Sunday, August 13th. My mistake. They moved in 2 days early. Did you get compensated for that, Mom? No. Well, I text the broker. I'm like, hey, your clients moved in Sunday. I did this on Monday, August 14th, and they didn't compensate my mom for 2 days. I did not receive a response. And I brought this up. Till this day, I bring it up. I think the broker was unprofessional. I will never go back to him again. So my advice to landlords, when you see tenants using the pre first of all, don't give tenants keys before their set move-in date. Do not. Legally, they're not entitled to the keys till the day they move in. I have to look up that on laws if they can get keys the day before. I think it's supposed to be the day of. Okay, let me think. Yeah. I think, yeah, the day before they should come, they should be given keys so that the day of set move-in date, they actually have the keys because that's their legal move-in date. Right. So do not give keys out any sooner than the day before the set move-in date. That will leave you with problems if your tenants are really inconsiderate, like our former tenants. That's my advice to you. If you see that they're using the premises before the set move-in date, say something in writing. Writing is the most important. Verbalize, then written. Let's see what other advice to give to landlords. Let me think. If you actually do see them moving, actually moving in 2 days sooner, or even a day sooner, step in and say, if you're going to move in today, which we did not agree, you owe me for that day. Verbalize and in writing, put it in writing. Make sure you get your money because they would want their money. If, let's say, they moved it out a day sooner, they would want their money, wouldn't they not? I mean, you're the landlord, it's a business deal, you're entitled to get paid retroactively. That's why I love Joe Lore from Highline Residential. He made sure my mom got paid 3 days early move-in, our new tenants, which are great, and they made sure she got the check. The new tenants were so considerate of my mom. Like, they see such a vast difference between our now tenants and our former tenants. That's why everything was a blessing in disguise, but that does not negate the fact that what the three former tenants did was wrong and illegal. They kept breaching the lease even before they moved in. So besides the fact I didn't pay my mom those 2 days, it shows what a low-life character they have. You're stealing from an elderly widow, mini-stroked, buried 2 daughters years ago. Psychologically, emotionally, she's not at her best, to say the least. So they move in. They have the absolute gall to call Verizon Fios and do drilling and installation in a landlord's home without permission. Written permission, tenants out there, you need to get written permission from the landlord to install or make any kind of alteration in their home. Verbal is not enough. Read your lease agreement. In the three former tenants' lease agreement, it was clause 7, alterations. You needed written permission. That's a violation. Right then and there, the landlord can say, you violated the lease. I'm entitled to your security deposit. Please find another place to live. That's what I read on New York State laws. Do your own research. Do not take my word for it. New York State law states when a tenant breaches the lease, the landlord is entitled to their security deposit. When you terminate the lease agreement without the consent of the landlord is entitled to your security deposit, tenants. I'm gonna take a short break right here. I'm gonna blow my nose. Be right back. Okay, so I'm back. Hi. So, as I was saying, so red flag, what are we up to? Red flag number 5 with the three former tenants. So what else? That was August 19, 2017, Saturday. They committed this violation. Sorry. Let's see. August 20th. It's evident to me and others in this home that there are plentitude of boxes, long, very long, 6 foot shorter. Shortest boxes must have brought in this insect. I don't even know what kind of an insect it was. From the pictures Petey showed me, I looked like a beetle. So August 20th, they start screaming over this beetle. It was at night, I think like 8:30 at night. To say the least, they startled me. I'm gonna move right along. Besides the fact that they basically snubbed me every time I asked them what was wrong. I finally got an answer when I said, I can't help you if I don't know why you're screaming. screaming. It's like, then Megan finally answers me. And in my opinion, being the child that she is, she tries to tell me they saw something on the wall the size of a rat. And she goes, and she gestures her hands like this, the size of the rat. And I've never seen a rat that's about 2 feet long that can actually crawl on walls, if unless you're watching a horror movie. So we finally got this thing they saw downsized to a 1.5 at the most inch insect with 6 legs. And this is what they're screaming over. And screaming and screaming reminded them my mom's sleeping. She's in bad health for mini stroke, and you're still screaming. Okay. What did we, like, red flag number 6? So I'm in the process. I'm just going to spray it with peppermint oil. And I was telling Katapano Fox in the courtroom, I like to use essential oils to spray in the summer because we have a garden. So, you know, spray to keep squirrels and birds away because they don't really like the peppermint. You know, they pick at my beans and my garden. It also will help with little ants, you know, it's nature. I mean, even if I didn't spray the peppermint oil to keep, like, little ants away, we don't get them in the house. But, you know, you take precaution because you don't know your next door neighbors. These are townhouses. They're attacked. Your next door neighbors, maybe they aren't so clean and they attract creatures. I call them creatures. So you want to take preventive measures. So I use essential oils. I was working at this job and one day I was startled by a little baby mouse, and that's when I started to do research on how to keep rodents and other creepy crawlers at a distance, and that's how I discovered essential oils. So you take preventive measures, and it's great to clean. It's great to clean your house with essential oils. So that's where my essential oils comes from. So I no sooner than turn my back to, like, to spray this insect, I hear the three of them screaming, "We found someone, we found someone," screaming, "We found someone," like three buffoons. I see them holding on. The three of them were holding on to a young male stranger. He couldn't have been more than 28. He had, like, mid late 20s. If that much. My mom saw him carrying one of those wheeler things, those suitcase rollers you take to the airport. So he must have been coming from the airport or going to the airport, whichever the case is. I'm like, "Who are you? Are you, don't tell me you're a total stranger." I was like, oh my god, this guy did not think he was here to actually squash a bug. I mean, it's summer, it's August, I'm in, like, a shirt, a summer shirt, short shorts. The two of them are in short shorts and a tank top. The other one had her PJs on or whatever she had on. I mean, this guy was checking us out. I mean, he did not want to leave. I mean, I had to literally yell at him, just squash it. Oh, please go by. Thank you. It was very creepy. These three females, very, in my mind, in my opinion, and from their actions, very immature, very considerate. They could have picked up some sex offender. And if anything happened to us that night, it would have been their responsibility. Oh, and you can bet I was gonna pull them into court. If anything bad happened, oh my God. But at that point, we weren't thinking about it so drastically. It's like we were all in the mindset of my mom moved from the second floor to the first floor for health reasons and extra income. My former boss, after my mom had a mini stroke, he laid me off about the week after. It's another story. Blessing in disguise. We needed extra income. And she needed a caregiver, me, her daughter, with her 24/7. I did not want to come home from work one day and find her dead on the floor. So, as I say, blessing in disguise that a boss laid me off. So, we're like, these three need like some kind of sisterly, motherly talking to. So I gave them my speech of like, I don't know how it is where you're from, out of state. Just trying to be like diplomatic. Maybe they live in a close-knit community. They grew up that way. But looking back, no, they didn't. I mean, they know more about I'm not even gonna say they know more about common sense because obviously they didn't. But they are aware of what can happen when you pick up a stranger off the street. A male stranger off the street. You're not like 4 years old. How could you not think? So, I gave them the little talking, like, please never do that again. That's why I left you the note and I mentioned about locking the top lock. Never pick up a stranger off the street and bring him into the home. Pick up a stranger off the street, bring him to home to squash a bug. One bug. One bug that your box is most likely brought in. Come on. So that was August 20th. My mom tried to tell him about recycling. I did, the way it's supposed to be done. I printed out a few sheets for them. So come Tuesday, I told them, we'll work with you. I'm gonna give you recycling booklet. Just knock on the door, let us know. That never happened. Totally snubbed us. Petey saw Rachel pulling a long, very long, about 6 foot long box out of the apartment. Her other two roommates must have been pushing it out. They literally must have slid it down the steps and laid it out in the front. Vertically blocking pedestrian pathway, and Petey sees this from the window, and he sees once again Rachel giggling, running inside, giggling. I don't know. It's like they're possessed by, Damien from The Omen. That little evil child from The Omen, and they think this is all funny. Like they're basically harassing an elderly, very sickly, poor English-speaking landlord. Their actions are that of harassment, and you're getting off on it. So, to make a long story short, I'm calling up my mom, but of course she's already asleep because, let's see, this happened about 9:15 at night, approximately August 22nd, Tuesday. She's already asleep. She doesn't pick up the phone. Kind of figured she would probably be asleep, but I thought maybe she would hear the phone ring. So I told Petey, come downstairs with me, please. I do not want to go by myself. I just did not want to knock on their door by myself. I'm not used to playing power of attorney, but I knew I had to say something. And we were just gonna ask them to please remove the recycling hazard, and I was gonna have another little talk with them again. Let's see. Petey knocked twice. This is Petey, and please keep in mind they formally met him the night of the insect incident, because I told him about it, and I said, you know, if you want to show them the picture you showed me, ease their minds and formally introduce yourself. He had already seen and met them informally on the steps as they all, well, basically Megan and Rachel, I think, he met on the steps as he was leaving for work. You know how you bump into each other. And when I say bump, I don't mean physically bump. It's a figure of speech. You know, so everyone was formally introduced the night of the insect incident. That's how I know Rachel to be the one who's about 4'10" with the craters in her face. Megan is the one with the dark hair. She's the tallest of the three. Very broad body. She has a wide, broad body. Her back and shoulders, very broad. And Janine with the thin lips and the small eyes. Very petite as well. We were introduced to each other. Rachel, Megan, Janine. And the reason why I bring that up is because Rachel and Megan switched names in the courthouse three times over. So, as I said, we were all formally introduced. This is Petey. I need to talk to you. Two knocks. No answer. Like, you could hear the little footsteps and like, ooh-hee, shh, that sort of thing. I'm like, just forget it, Petey. Just remove, please, the box so no one gets hurt. Trips over, goes flying. And me and Mommy will talk to them tomorrow. So I'm like thinking, oh Lord, have mercy. He runs down the steps. He's handling the recycling hazard. Mom wakes up because she hears him in the hall. I'm just on the steps like, oh Lord, have mercy. Like, so happy the apartment got rented. But we rented it out to three, like, Damien children. So, you know, Mom's asking what's going on. Petey's telling her. He's venting to her in the hall. I'm venting to Petey. I said, it's okay. Don't worry about it. There was no yelling going on. No cursing. I said something to the effect the three of them are enough to give Mommy another stroke. or something to that effect. Some reference to her mini stroke. I don't know how many minutes later, maybe 10, 15 minutes after that, I'm outside with my mom and Petey, standing over the recycling hazard, and pulls up police car from the 114 precinct. Out comes this cop, like, he's, you know, like, you know, he's thinking he's all big and bad. His partner wasn't too bad, but him, I forget his name. Ugh. He has such an attitude, like most cops do. Like, I got a gun and a badge, and I'm all big and bad. Yeah, okay. So anyway, we're telling them what's going on. Like, we couldn't believe they called the cops. Like, at first, none of us thought they did. It's like, cops pull out, say, okay, what's going on here? It's like, huh? Ooh. He tells us he got a call to this house, from this house. Oh. So, me and Peter are talking to the cops, and my mom is like, oh, no, cops. You know, when she sees cops, she thinks, oh. She remembers my younger sister's suicide and other things. And so, the three of them, we can see them. They're at the window. So at one point, they come running down the stairs, and Rachel says, I called the cops. I called them. Okay, why? We never got a straight answer. Like, it was the three of them, me, Mom, Petey, and the two cops. And we're like, why did you call the cops? My mom's asking. Petey's asking. Janine says to Petey, we thought you were a stranger knocking on our door. Megan Lewis writes in her police report, and obviously she's writing it also on behalf of her two roommates. She writes that myself, me, landlord's daughter, and Petey came in to slam in their door, cursing, screaming. So basically, they're accusing us of trying to break in their door. The officers of the 114 precinct concluded that me and Petey were truthful. We told them the details of everything, the way they were acting. We only knocked on their door. I told the officers I asked Petey to come with me. He always helps out with recycling and trash. I appointed him like little mini manager. My mom is a widow. I'm the only daughter left. I mean, out of love, like, we try to help out. Somehow that became a crime. So, officers favored our truth over the three deception. They filled out a police report of false accusations. And another advice to landlords, if a tenant falsely accuses you, that's a crime. It can vary from misdemeanor to felony. Do your research, talk to a lawyer, and take it another step further if that's the way you want to and need to go. Officers left. Of course, we were not arrested because no such actions as they claim happened. We never saw a police report that night, and Petey went the next day, I think, or, well, he called his lawyer when he heard we were being falsely accused. It went from, we thought you were a stranger knocking on our door, which that is not true because you knew it was us. Petey knocked, this is Petey, I need to talk to you. I said under my breath, and Demi again. And even if I did not say Demi, you know, If it's Petey, you hear my voice, you recognize my voice, it's Demi. I mean, they knew I was there. They accused both of us in the police report that we were trying to slam in their door. We thought you were a stranger knocking on their door. Think about that. Think about the senselessness in your false accusations. So, he tries to get a police report. He can't get it. Like, nothing. So We really don't know exactly at this point what they wrote in the police report. October 19th, me and my mom attempt to get a copy of it because we were going to small claims court at that point and just wanted to know, really curious, and to bring the copy with us. Front desk officer looked under all the names I gave him, and I left no stone unturned. The report is not filed. It's not here. It's not in their computer. It's physically not at the 114 precinct, he said to me. It was so, I'm trying to find a exact word he used. He goes, it was probably so nothing. They probably just, and you know, of course, I'm always saying, oh, they did away with it or never, you know, never filed it. Okay, that's great. So that's in our favor when we go to small claims court case. He goes, don't worry about it. It's, you know, okay, great. What happened that night, August 22nd, they basically abandoned the apartment. We never understood why. I mean, you made us feel unsafe in our own home. You called officers falsely against us. You're doing all these wrongs, and you basically abandon the apartment. You don't say a word to the landlord. Why? I don't think it's because they were ashamed of calling officers on us, because they have no shame. They haven't paid their electric bill. They never compensated my mom. And all the actions I described, obviously, from your perspective, in your opinion, in your mind, do they have any kind of shame? No. I was outside because I got dressed, need to go for a walk. I see them with their handbags leaving. I figured, I don't know, they're going to Burger King or dinner or whatever. I don't know. Rachel sees it's drizzling and she curses in front of the cop and says, oh great, it's fucking raining, that's all I need. Oh, that's all you need? Let me play the violin for you. You're, in my mind, in my opinion, you're just a horrible human being. You and your roommates. Oh, that's all I fucking need. Like, who are you? Like, go with your crater face. And then she has craters in her face. And I'm not making fun of that. But you laughed at my mom that night. Petey saw Rachel from the window laughing at my mom in her robe and nightgown, struggling with her recycling hazard. You're laughing at a sickly, dying elderly woman. Great, Rachel. Look in the mirror and laugh at the craters in your face. Or Janine, laugh at your thin lips, your little beady mousy eyes. Or Megan, why don't you laugh at your broad body and that scrunched up, that kind of square chin, that squashed up face of yours. I mean, look in the mirror. Better yet, look inside your souls, because in my mind, you don't have souls. In my mind, in my opinion, your morals, the morals that have been projected into, is shameful. It's shameful. It's, you're disgusting people, in my opinion. You're like, you're even lower than that insect on the wall. That's my opinion. So, after frantic worry, my mom's like, where are they? They'll be back. They have a 1-year lease agreement. Still, at this point, we're like, nobody told them to leave. My mom wasn't gonna tell them to leave. And they did so much. I guess at that point, we were just thinking, there's a 1-year lease agreement. We signed it. Like, maybe we can all sit down and talk to each other, but the tenants never gave us that chance. Like, you know, talk to them like face to face. Why did you call the cops? I'm like, why are you doing all these actions. Why are you committing all these actions? All these negative actions. Right then, August 22nd, when they falsely called the police on the landlord and family, New York state law, landlord has a right to tell them to leave. And landlord has a right to their security deposit. And this is what I want to stress. Landlords, do not be afraid to stand up for your rights. They literally breached the lease over and over again. They disappeared. I had to call their broker twice. My mom runs to her probate lawyer. Oh my God, probate lawyer. God, he's a wussy. In my mind, he is a wussy. Because we found out after I had to call the broker twice that they're looking for another apartment. Oh, when are you going to let the landlord know? Your lease says you have to give the landlord 60-day notice. Once again, they violated a clause in the lease agreement. But because Katapano, this is what I personally believe, is of Jewish faith, and I believe she also has German in her, and at least one of the roommates has German in her, I believe, and all three are Jewish faith, from my understanding and to the best of my knowledge. And this is why she sided with them. My mom runs to her probate lawyer to find out what her rights are. They're about to break the lease. September's rent is coming up. Like, my mom all had all these frantic thoughts going on in her head. Keep in mind, she buried two daughters, is a widow. I suffer from post-concussion syndrome. My mom has her own health problems, so her state of mind is not at the best. And she's thinking bills, money, property tax. So the probate lawyer, like, if he had any kind of brain, would have said, look, here's a landlord-tenant lawyer. This is not my field. I don't know, out of courtesy, did he feel sorry for her? But if he really felt sorry for her, send her to a landlord-tenant lawyer. I mean, you must have known someone. He takes it upon himself, out of niceness, I don't know, to call up the broker. Maybe my mom was crying and begging, I don't know. But he calls up the broker. Yeah, maybe because he saw my mom so frantic. He says, the broker, he says to the probate lawyer, they found an apartment and will vacate Anastasia's premises September 1st. Oh, let's see. So, the three former tenants, besides violating clause after clause in the lease agreement, have now terminated the lease agreement without the consent of the landlord and will take up days in September to move out and not compensate the landlord. My mom hears this. She says to probate lawyer, after conversation with broker, between broker and probate lawyer was over, she's keeping the security deposit. She's entitled to it. That much we told her. August 24th, me and Petey told her, oh, they're about to break the lease. You're entitled to the security deposit. And she did say, I will keep it for September's rent. Probate lawyer says they will most likely take you into court for the security deposit. My mom says, so be it. She keeps the security deposit. Come August 27th, they vacated. August 27th, Sunday. Meanwhile, the broker says they're vacating September 1st. So we were surprised to see them August 27th. You know, landlord can't jump in front of a tenant and say, you're not leaving. You have to take proper steps. And the probate lawyer failed to tell my mom the proper steps. When she came home Saturday, I did my own research. More so Monday, when I received from the probate lawyer a draft of a surrender release. I said, what is this? I called him up and left a message. I told him I opened up your attachment, your email. I read it. Don't think mom's gonna like this. But I said I will translate it for her. Obviously, that's why he sent it to me, and explain it to her, which I did August 29th. I didn't explain it to her that day because she was still upset that the three former tenants, the three females, vacated, and we had to start the re-renting process over again. And as I told the probate lawyer, as I knew she would not like it, yeah, she got upset, like, I did not tell them to leave, did not force them to leave. You want me to basically give up my rights? Because at this point, I was telling my mom her rights as I researched them. And when I researched surrender release Monday, I discovered not only can she keep the deposit, but she can sue for the remainder of the lease. Of course, the landlord must mitigate damages, which I did for her, not just because it's required by law, but for the sake of her sanity. Yeah, mitigate damages, try to find a replacement for the lease. When they vacated the 27th, my Anastasia, the landlord, did not ask for keys. Keys were not given. They even locked the top block. It's like, oh, they locked the top block now. You know, how ironic. I researched thoroughly, and I explained to my mom. She said she will not sign the surrender release. I left a message for the probate lawyer August 29th. I think it was about 3:30 in the afternoon. Between the 29th and September 10th, I heard nothing further. So we're thinking and discussing, oh, did they finally realize they're wrong? They're forfeiting the security deposit because mom's entitled to it. You know, I emailed my research to the probate lawyer and I told him, convey this to them, convey that to them. Oops. Thought I heard something. September 11th, I received a signed by tenants only, notarized by tenants, August 28th, surrender of lease. George Lazaridis, the notary, notarized them and put only. In other words, the tenants only are signing and notarizing this. And he has their driver's license numbers, each of them, as they signed it. So to prove their identity is very simple, with a driver's license. And also, I saw them snooping through my linked profile. So I went to theirs and I printed out a picture of Rachel. I have a picture of Janine from Facebook, and I have a picture of Megan from Facebook to prove their identities. That's another way, because as I said, Rachel and Megan switched names, identities in the court. So as I researched, found out things, emailed it to the probate lawyer, I emailed their broker, I also texted him, you still owe my mom 2 days. It's like, I get an okay. I mean, my mom never got paid those 2 days. I sent a letter to their broker to give it to them, because the only thing we knew is that the broker found them an absentee landlord home. I won't say what street or boulevard, but it's here. Near enough where I live, it's an absentee landlord home. That alone says something. We didn't have an exact address for me to send the a letter reminding them that they're still obligated under the lease, blah blah blah, and so on. We were hoping we would rent it in September, but you know, it seemed, it just didn't have a feeling it was gonna get rented in September, and it didn't. But October came, and we have great new tenants. October 29th, they moved in. And so now we're going to sue for the remainder of the lease, which was October 1st through October 28th. We received their small claims documents October 19th, I think it was. And they had out-of-state addresses. I could have sent the letter there, but I'm figuring it's their parents' home. I sent it to the broker as a third party, you know, for him to convey the message and show them the letter. I also mailed it to him, but I didn't certify it. To move right along, September 27th, the three of them came to the house, you know, the house they say they fear. When my mom opened the door, I was going up the steps and I heard their voices, and they were angrily wanting the security deposits. I went back down the stairs, they saw me, they didn't run for their lives. That again proves they had no fear of me or us. I told them once again, talk to the probate lawyer why the landlord is entitled to the security deposit, why she's entitled to sue for the remainder of the lease. Megan says, I just want you to know, if you don't give us a security deposit, we're going to sue you for moving expenses. Moving expenses you left on your own. Well, I just want you to know that. Okay. Bye. Landlord, stand up for your rights. Even if you get a, if you believe that you will get a biased judge, like the three of them, I believe Jewish faith. The judge was of Jewish faith. She's looking for a loophole to side with them. Stand up for your right. If a judgment is awarded against you, if you're elderly, disabled, talk to a lawyer. What you can do to prevent them from getting that judgment, you can be judgment exempt, which I researched and my mom was, but she was like, just, I'm just gonna write them the check. And another thing I want to stress is, small claims case, the max was $5,000. Megan kept insisting there were one case, yet they filed three different claims, and it totaled up to over $6,000. Even though Katapano Fox angrily reprimanded them, and Megan was trying to find excuse, Katapano Fox made a point, and she seemed very kind of angry at them and Megan. Megan did all the talking, but she introduced herself as Rachel. But I made it known to the judge that Megan Lewis is the one speaking. Oops. Okay, I have to. Oh, no. Okay, I'll cut out that part where I said her last name. But, okay, I said Megan is the one speaking. Oh, great. Now I have to edit it. Okay, no problem. I guess perjury in Queens County Courthouse is doable. I also told the Hispanic, I believe she was court clerk, March 12th, in room 308. I showed her proof that Rachel and Megan are switching identities. And we all have our theory as to why. And when I wrote the judicial department and other legals assembly man And whoever else I wrote to that has to do with the elderly and the courts, I explained to them and I attached proof how Rachel and Megan switched names, and I gave them the reason we believe they switched names. I imagine they're very biased against landlords, and considering you're Greek, I think that also too is a bias that they hold there. From talking to other people, from what I witnessed, the Hispanic court clerk in room 308 on March 12th was pretty nasty. She wasn't giving Anastasia's side a chance for the defense to be heard. Rachel and Megan claimed to have IDs, you know, and they gestured like they were going to pull out the IDs. See, they try to use the power of suggestion to manipulate weaker minds, but they're not manipulating my mind. Complaints and grievances were filed against the Hispanic court clerk. The court officer in room 308 was really nice to me. He said, "Nothing of what goes on in this room will be transferred over to the judge's room." I'm like, yeah, but she's being biased. Is she not? She's not listening to the landlord's side. And they're perjuring themselves. Perjury is not against the law in a courtroom anymore. The whole thing was not based on principle, was not based on law, no morals. My strong opinion is this. I mean, if Megan and her two roommates are going on how them and the landlord agreed to surrender the lease, then Katapano Fox, are you not thinking, then why are they suing for moving expenses? I mean, why did you award them the moving expenses as well? And I also believe they sued for the difference in security deposit. I'm not really sure. Like, I tuned them out at one point because the whole thing was such a circus. I mean, here is a judge, Katapano Fox. You're reprimanding them for insisting they're all one case, because obviously, in my mind, they're saying they're all one case, because when you have three persons trying to keep a deceptive story straight, you're more prone to getting caught in the deceit, even though Megan did get caught in the deceit, even though she did all the talking. They're insisting they're one case. Think, judge, why are they? Yet they filed three different claims and you're reprimanding them, yet you awarded this. I mean, you literally did not follow any of the rules or laws. I showed them a rejected surrender release, meaning the court. Yet the county court clerk, March 12th, room 308, she's like, okay, at one point you all agreed to surrender the lease. No, that never happened. They took it upon themselves to terminate the lease. How is it that a landlord agreed to surrender a lease? Meanwhile, keep in mind, my mom is born in Cyprus. She went to school in Cyprus, fifth grade level. That's it. We're talking about in ancient times. Even I didn't know what a surrender of lease was, or that it existed. It was the first time I heard about it. I mean, it's self-explanatory to me, surrender of lease, because I'm born and raised in America. I'm fluent in English. But landlord-tenant terms, I was not aware of them. Can you imagine how much less my mom was? My mom, in her, there was no such thing as a surrender of lease in her mind when she was going to the probate lawyer. It was something that just did not exist in her reality. It did not exist in my reality, and I was born and raised in America and New York. So how is it that the judge wants to keep harping that my mom went to the probate lawyer to draft this surrender of lease? How can my mom go to a probate lawyer to draft a surrender of lease when she doesn't even know it exists, when she just told me that day, August 24th, she told me she's keeping the security deposit. We encouraged her to because it was her entitlement. Why would she go to a probate lawyer? Let's say she knew what a surrender of lease was. Let's say. Why would she go to the probate lawyer and ask him to draft it, giving up her right to the security deposit? Why? And the surrender lease basically said, it's okay that you violated the clauses. Like, why would my mom, if she had knowledge and understanding of a surrender of lease, then she would have knowledge and understanding that she could have sued for the remainder of the lease. Why would she give that up? And I brought that point up to Katapano Fox. But as I said, the bias against the landlord for being Eastern Orthodox Christian, this is what I believe. For being Cypriot Greek, this is what I believe. For not being of Jewish faith, this is what I believe. Sided with the three former, in my opinion, bully tenants. It's obvious and evident. They said it themselves. If you don't give us our security deposit, we're going to sue you for moving expenses, retaliation. Meanwhile, Megan says that we were angry at them and this is why we're suing them for the remainder of the lease. No, you silly little fool. The landlord is suing you because she's entitled to sue you. Now, my mom was going to appeal it. Neighbors said you have to think of your health. I said it. Think of your health. Petey said it. Think of your health. She will make up for the money. We'll call it just for the damages she incurred. You have to remember there are by far greater things in life than monetary funds. Yeah, we all need money for a roof over our head, for food, and so forth in this sad world. I get that. You'll make up for the money. You did not have to pay it to them. She is judgment exempt. She had to go through a lawyer to do all this. And I did speak to lawyers, and I have several lawyers in the woodworks, actually. I have to finally choose one. I'm still looking for a criminal defense lawyer. Basically, that's my mom, Anastasia's small claims case. I hope I didn't leave anything out. Don't be afraid to fight for your rights, even if you know you're going to be biased against. Appeal. If my mom was healthier, she said she would have most certainly appealed with a lawyer. Do not be afraid to file complaints against the judge when you know they did wrong. Do not be afraid to talk about your small claims case if you have been unjustifiably treated. Do not be afraid to defend yourself. Like, I really feel for the elderly landlords out there, the elderly, the disabled, the way they're treated from what I read and from what I heard from others in that Queens County courthouse is a sin. Why is this allowed? So many injustices in this world. Remember, when persons like those three former bully tenants, and in my mind, in my opinion, they are bullies. Remember, they're unhappy within themselves, so they want to project their unhappiness into you. Do not allow it. Do not allow it. You just continue with your life. Think more of yourself. Speak up, stand up for yourself and your rights. If a judge does you wrong, mistreats you as Katapano Fox mistreated my mom, this is another point I want to bring up. At some point, my mom stood up because, I believe she stood up because the judge, you know, those long sleeves, she did a gesture like this, I guess to toss her sleeves back, Katapano Fox, with your broken long nose and your little beady eyes. My mom stood up because she assumed the judge told her rise. I was already standing. Believe I just took the oath or was about to. So Katapano Fox comes out with, she's leaving. She's leaving. Like, well, I don't know. What is she talking about? She's pointing to my mom. She's leaving. My mom's just standing there in discomfort, holding onto the desk. I'm trying to tell Katapano Fox, my mama had a mini stroke in 2016. The Greek interpreter of my mom's already told her that, and that I would speak for her. I'm a power of attorney, and asked on my behalf if that would be okay. And she did say, yes, you know, I have that legal right. I'm a power of attorney. But Katapano Fox kept going on, and my mom was leaving. Why did she stand up? First she's leaving, then she's just standing up. Why? She went on and on. Why? Humiliating her. I repeatedly told Katapano Fox she had a mini stroke in 2016. She becomes confused. I think she became confused, maybe. You gesture to stand up. I didn't gesture. Katapano Fox, we're talking about an elderly woman who is obviously confused. And I just told you and reminded you, the Greek interpreter told you, mini stroke. Do you know what a mini stroke does to a human mind, a human brain, rather? But she kept going on and on. She tells me to sit. She goes, I sit. She's still going on about it. So I'm holding my head, my mouth is dry because I'm feeling so bad for my mom. She finally stops. I just went on. I think she gets confused. Mini stroke. And the three former evil ones, in my mind, in my opinion, they're evil ones. They seem to be enjoying this. This is how ugly they are inside. Never mind that their physical appearance is unappealing. But inside, they're just as ugly, if not uglier, if that's possible. Also, at one point, Katapano Fox asks me, and think about this. She goes, do you need a Greek interpreter as well? She's asking someone she knows is raised and born in America, educated in America, fluent in English. I'm conversing in English. I'm conversing to the court officer. Obviously, I'm power of attorney. I'm fluent in English. Duh. She's asking someone in English if they need a Greek interpreter. think about that. So, Katapano Fox, you made a fool of yourself throughout the universe. You think that is something that is going to weigh me down? Or do you actually think I'm going to allow you trying to humiliate my mom? Do you think I'm going to let that weigh me down or weigh my mom down? No, I'm going to keep reminding her, myself, and the universe that people of that nation, of that nature, persons of that nature, their minds, their brains feel so ugly inside. They feel worthless. So they want to project that into you. Do you not realize that you're showing the universe how ugly you are inside? And instead of trying to make yourself a kinder person, a happier person, you rather expend that energy, that negative energy you have inside yourself. You would rather project it, make an attempt to project it into someone else to satisfy your ugliness and your evilness at that point. See, it makes no sense. It really makes no sense to me. When persons are so insecure, and this is how the mindset of the bully works. Like bullies at school, bullies at work, bullies in general, they feel ugly about themselves. It could be they feel ugly physically, spiritually, soulfully. They're unhappy in their lives and want to project that into someone else because of that moment. They're projecting it into someone else. Maybe that moment, it gives them some kind of evil, sadistic satisfaction that somehow in that moment, they don't feel alone in their misery because they're trying to make someone else feel their misery by attempting to make them miserable. Your greatest defense against the mindset of those persons is making your own mind stronger. Make your own mind stronger. Think more of yourself. Meditation, read, use your voice. There's so much to do. Look within yourself. Make your mind stronger. Make your mind stronger. You create a barrier against people like Katapano, like persons like the former bully tenants. Make your mind stronger. Stand up for what you believe in. Bullies do not stand up for what they believe in. They try to stomp on others' righteousness, and I'm not saying that me and my family are perfect. We are not, but we don't commit actions to purposely humiliate someone. Would never think of overstepping myself in a landlord's home, falsely calling officers. There should be strong penalties against falsely calling cops. Really, there should be. The three former bully tenants, it seems like they had help from their parents, because Megan created, actually her father's name is Gary, We all know that. We all know her father's name. And the header on their receipts, their moving receipts, read the father's name. That's Megan's father. I researched it. I mean, I can prove everything I'm saying. I have all the documents printed out. So my question is, did their parents instill the lack of morals within them? But you're at an age where you decide who you want to be. If you feel like your parents instilled some immorals in you, do you not have enough of a mind to say, I don't want to be like this. I'm wrong. The way I'm treating this elderly, sickly landlord, I'm wrong. Did you ever stop to think about that? No, because you know, you decide you want to be just as ugly. So I've been rambling on. Hopefully I'll edit this video and put it on YouTube. And my advice, I hope, helps someone out there. Be prepared, educate yourself. Know your landlord rights. Be your own advocate. Always, always make a lease agreement. It will protect you, even though it doesn't seem so at the moment, like you get a judge like Katapana Fox. But, you know, I haven't stopped. I'm sending out the lease agreements. I'm sending out the letters. I'm sending out my proof. So, like I said, get that lease agreement, add clauses if you have to, make sure they are within the state law, go with righteousness. My mom was most certainly entitled to the security deposit and to sue for the remainder of the lease. She should listen to me and went to a landlord tenant lawyer. I told her I would look for one. I mean, there just wasn't enough time. Everything was happening so fast. Even like now, I mean, it takes time to find a good lawyer and actually choose one. Everything happened so fast. I tried to advocate for her. I learned so much. Now she knows what a surrender of lease is. Like, it'll all be okay. If you have any questions, if you can make sense of all my rambling, you know, post your questions, landlords. There's a lot of tenants out there that take such advantage of landlords. It's a shame. Oh, one other thing I want to stress is when a tenant gives you notice, and they're supposed to give you at least 30-day notice, they're moving out. They are not supposed to live within that month under the security deposit. That's not rent. Landlords, speak up. Tell them, better yet, not verbally, in writing, you owe me rent. The security deposit is not last month's rent. Security deposit is not used for that. Landlords, you need to stand up for that right, because you are the ones smothering that right. It's your fault, landlords. Before they move out, go. Oh, and there's my mom buzzing. Have a walkthrough, inspect everything, get everything in writing. I have to go for now. You're probably like, yay, she's gonna shut up now. Okay, I really have to go. She's buzzing. Mother downstairs.